Welcome everybody. This is the first ever Life After Sport. I'm Eric, I'm a junior, and I'm one of the SAAC co-presidents. Thank you for coming out tonight. I think you really enjoy this event. SAAC has spent a lot of time working on this, and I'd also like to thank Jen Chucks. She poured a lot of time and effort into this, and she's really glad for about the turnout. The format tonight will consist of our panelists and our moderator, Nick Fogel. Nick is founder of Jigsaw. It's a company that connects students like us to jobs that best suit our liberal arts background. Nick was a very prominent figure at Williams. He was an athlete. He's also a CC co-president. At lunch today, he shared a story about his recent college football tour. It sounded amazing. Hopefully, he'll share a little bit more about that. But right now, I'm going to hand it over and let him lead the night.
Well, thank you guys for coming out, and thank you SAAC and for putting this on, and Jen, DQ, everyone who put in all the work to bring us back. We're recent grads, 2012, a bunch of 2013, and a couple of 2014, so we all jump at the opportunity to come back whenever we can. So we're excited to tell you a little bit about our experiences and have a great time. But I'm gonna start by just sharing a quick video about my sort of experiences. I went on a trip starting last summer, traveling across the country, interviewing alums in all different fields, trying to learn about different opportunities that existed for students coming from Williams so that it could help sort of shed some light on the paths outside of the really traditional paths. And so I felt like it sort of blended in well with the mission of the night, and that's why Jen thought of me. So I'll start off with that, and then we'll jump into talking to these guys.
One 100 years ago, in a little town in Minnesota, lived a boy who called.
Figuring out what to do after graduation was difficult. I was aware of alums in many fields, but they were all big names: congressmen, television hosts, famous actors. In my mind, they were mythical figures, predestined for greatness, more fairy tale than role model. How did they get there? What are the range of career options that exist for Williams graduates?
She said, "Hey, Gil, you wouldn't believe what lies out there beyond those trees. Would you let me take you out to sea? So pack up your bags and fly. You've got some living before you die. I got this."
Over the past 5 months, I've spoken with artists and activists, entrepreneurs and farmers, musicians and fashion designers.
So Marie and Gil, they took to the hills and climbed 100 miles until they found a spot where
the stories I heard were an affirmation of the broad power of the liberal arts and confirmation that there is no right way to live up to the Williams ideal.
Tallest trees, so naturally they became king and queen. But before they laid their regal ground, the sky had darkened all around. The heavens broke and rain began to fall. The lightning cracked, thunder clapped, and soon the king and queen were trapped on an island sinking in the rising flood. Poor Marie, she said, "The end's begun. I've always had a place to run. I'm certain that this night will be our last." But Gil said, "Marie, you wouldn't believe what lies inside of you and me. Take my hand and we can be at ease. So lay down and close your eyes. You've got some dreaming before you die. I got this feeling. Don't ask me why. Don't ask me why. Don't ask me why. I promise you this too shall pass." even if this night is our last.
I'm afraid
I promise you this too shall
make a mistake,
even if this night is
to
our
stay.
Last. For 40 hours the storm raged on, and Gil, he said, I had it wrong. If we don't leave, we're surely gonna die. But sweet Marie, she said, I see the light. My dear McGill, you had it right. We just needed a little faith before we fly. Because I've dreamed of what this world could be in all its possibility. And I'll be damned if I don't get to see. So take my hand and hold it tight. We're gonna make it out.
By engaging with these stories and listening to the ups and downs in each, I walked away more hopeful than intimidated. What Williams gives us, more than anything else, are the tools to create our own journey.
So as you can probably tell from the video, I guess my experience at Williams were pretty similar to sort of the theme of this event. So great educational experience, had a fantastic sort of eye-opening experience in many ways, learning about interests I didn't know I had. And then at the end of it, felt like it was really hard to figure out how to transition those interests into real-world employment. I think that's sort of the theme of tonight. And so we want to start by sort of talking with panelists about that, and especially sort of the pressure to go certain paths. I think we know at Williams there's a couple of paths that are very obvious, and you get to be a junior and senior, and almost by default, everyone's sort of running to the same internships, and the same industries tend to attract a really wide range of people. So I want to start by, before I get there, let's have you guys introduce yourselves. And then we'll jump into that. So start down here, Finn, you want to?
All right, yeah. I'm Finn Fine. I graduated in 2013. I played goalkeeper for the men's soccer team. I was a psychology major. After graduating, I worked for a year as a financial services headhunter in New York City. And for the last 2 years, I've been an assistant soccer coach at Catholic University in Washington, D.C. And Fun fact, when I was at the tender age of 5 years old, I was present for the only Williams Men's Soccer National Championship title, which was here at Coalfield, and there we go.
Well, I'm Jake Abrahams. I graduated in 2014. I played golf. I was an econ major, and now I work at NBC Sports as a researcher. I guess a year and a half now. And fun fact, I guess Nick was my favorite.
My name is Grace Beckhorst. I also graduated in 2013. I was on the women's basketball team. I was a history major with a concentration in leadership studies. For the past 2 years prior to this one, I was the first assistant and recruiting coordinator for the women's basketball program at Connecticut College. And this is my first year at Northfield Mount Hermon. It's a boarding school, an hour across Route 2. I am the head girls basketball coach, and I am a admissions counselor. And a fun fact about me is I was on the SAAC board for 3 years and co-president my senior year. I also was in combo soft, which, as you all know, or you should, is the only and elite improv group on campus.
I'm Megan Casey. I also graduated in 2013. I played softball. I work at ESPN. I started in August after my senior year. I'm a content associate, which is essentially a production assistant, on Monday Night Countdown and NFL Insider Sunday Edition. And fun fact about me, I ate the same sandwich at Papa Charlie's so many times they informally named it for me.
What was it?
That is
turkey cheddar, lettuce mayo, and there. A week.
All right, my name is Garen Hartwell. This class is 2013. I play football and baseball here. Same major as Grace, actually, history with the concentration in leadership studies. So right after I graduated, I spent a year interning for the New England Patriots in the PR department. And then from there, I went to work for NESN, New England Sports Network, starting in 2014 in the spring. And I took over covering the beat for the Celtics, so I cover Celtics games and cover the Celtics on a regular basis. Fun fact, I did an internship during winter study 2011 covering the Bruins for ESPN Boston. I only went to about 5 games over the course of, I think, January. They went on to win the Stanley Cup, so I'm just going to take credit for that.
Hi, I'm Rhea Grandi. I graduated in 2014. I ran cross country and track here. I majored in English and computer science. After I graduated last year, I was a digital media associate at ESPN, which is like this weird 1-year rotational program they have. I did a lot of really different things. I covered the New York Marathon and helped launch the redesign of the website. Like, that is how different they were. And now I'm a product manager for Watch ESPN, so I'm working on the website as well on that side. Fun fact, my freshman year at Williams, I was in belt choir and like hand belt choir, and I'm pretty sure it folded the year after that. Yeah.
Awesome. So now that I sort of preempted this question, want to throw it out to you guys. You guys all are now working in sports, which is obviously it's a difficult field to break into. Also, a field that probably a lot of alums, given that there are a lot of students, given that 40% of the student body are athletes, think about at least at some point during their time at Williams. So, wondering, as you guys were going into junior, senior year, starting to think about what you might do afterwards, if you felt pressure to go sort of more traditional paths, and how did you sort of end up where you are? And given that sports is such a difficult field to break into. So we can start down there and then feel free to sort of jump in.
All right. So as I mentioned before, I spent my first year out working as a headhunter in New York. When I graduated, I didn't really have a great sense of what I wanted to do. And without really thinking about it, unconsciously, I didn't even consider working in sports as an option. It was kind of like, all right, which of these, I want to be in a city. What can I do? I picked a job I thought would be well suited to me. And so I worked as a headhunter for a year in New York, and it was not for me, to say the least. And I realized it was kind of sold as a team. I worked on a team, but sort of the parts of being on a team that I had liked about sports weren't really there, and I realized the best part of my week by far was the 1 hour on Wednesdays when I played soccer. And so I was like, well, maybe I could just do this all the time. And so I kind of started reaching out and to some coaches and basically just asking, how did you get here? What's the best way to do it? Do you know of anything? And sort of kept pulling the thread, one thing led to another. And the contact of the contact put me in touch with the coach who I now work for at Catholic. And really for me it was, I tried it out, and I wouldn't change it. I learned a lot about myself and what I value and kind of what is important to me working in a job I hated. But at the end of the day, I realized that working in sports was, that's my passion, as I assume it is for all of these guys and probably a lot of you because you're here and you play sports at Williams. And so it kind of found me. I realized I wasn't happy doing a more traditional route, and so I just kind of made it happen.
Yeah, mine's a little bit different. I came to Williams mostly for basketball and stayed for a lot more reasons than that. And I came in saying, I'm going to be a lawyer. My dad's a lawyer, my aunt's a lawyer, my sister's going to be a lawyer, I'm going to be a lawyer. And went into my senior year, took a research job with a very well-known professor so she could write my recommendation for law school. Spent my first 3 months in Sawyer, battling between my thesis and studying for the LSAT. And I went home to Garfield one night. Yes, I lived in Garfield, and it's a shame it's no longer going to be a dorm. crying to my roommate that I was miserable. And she said, Grace, if you don't like me, you're going to change it. And then I went crying to my coach because I didn't find the advice helpful, Emily. Then I went crying to my coach, and she goes, of all my players, you're the smartest. Your basketball IQ is the smartest. And I'm like, well, why don't I play anymore? and so from that day forward, I kind of really switched gears and decided to focus on coaching. So I actually got into coaching by applying for a conference at the Final Four called So You Want to Be a Coach. Only 50 athletes are taking a year. I was the only Division III athlete taking my year. And basically, the conference for young women who want to become coaches. And from that, I met the Connecticut College coach who had actually recruited me at Holy Cross when he was there. I was not going to go to Holy Cross. And then that's kind of how I felt into that. But I thought law school all the way. And it made sense to me going to the best school in the country that should take a traditional path.
And is it difficult for you, and we talked a little bit before, that sort of sacrifice of going, you know, law school is like a prestigious thing. You're probably going to be compensated pretty well, and then, you know, taking a coaching job and not totally knowing the path in that field, was that a scary thing?
That is scary. So law school, obviously you invest again in law school, or my parents would invest again for me to go to law school, and then the dividend on the outside would be a large paycheck, a really nice job, and then my first paycheck, not my first paycheck, my total salary at Connecticut College was $15,800 for an entire year. That was my full-time job. I worked 80 hours a week for 5 months, and I loved it. I ate in the dining hall a lot, stole a lot of food from Connecticut College, but that's a sacrifice I was willing to make to be happy. A lot of my best friends from Williams, not that they're unhappy, but they're in the cities and they're in New York, and every time I go to New York, I think to myself, wow, I would love to live in New York, but I would hate to work behind a desk. And every day, I would go to a basketball gym and teach the sport that I love and be around kids who love, be on a team. And I'm happy, and I don't think I can put, this sounds so cheesy. I don't think I put a price on being happy.
And what about you guys? So you guys are in more of an office setting, at least that you stand there and you're writing a little bit. How did you guys sort of find your way there?
When I was at Williams, I actually wanted to like work for a team, like be a scout, and like, really go like that kind of route. And that didn't work out, and I got really interested in media, interned at NBC, and then actually ended up at ESPN through like NESCAC contacts. So the guys sort of who helped me get left in the door were an amateur alum and a base alum. And they had worked for the same guy I worked for at NBC. So they were like, we feel like your path is really similar to ours. We will meet you, and all that kind of stuff, and sort of got my foot in the door.
And how'd you make that connection? How'd you know that they were there?
So I worked for sports information for a couple of years, so DQ was huge in that.
Yeah, I also took the path for DQ. I think I, for me personally, I knew pretty early on that I wasn't, you know, cut out for more of a traditional path. I think it was my freshman spring, I took Econ 110, and you know, no offense to any Econ majors in the room, I had no idea what was going on. I was pretty overwhelmed, so I, you know, I figured that sort of anything, helping numbers, any sort of that path wasn't really cut out for me. I think it was my sophomore year, DQ approached me and said, you know, we need a mentor curator for the website. I took him up mine, and that was kind of when I decided, all right, you know, this is kind of fun. You know, I enjoy sports. And you know, not that I enjoy writing papers, but I did like writing, and that kind of went from there. You helped me find an internship, junior year, working for ESPN Boston, covering the Boston Red Sox over the summer, and that was kind of my first time, you know, in the field, really, really doing it, you know, really covering, really being out there, doing it on a day-to-day basis. And I liked it enough to say, all right, I need to come back to this. I need to, you know, pursue this further. Yeah.
I really thought I wanted to be a writer, basically, from getting to Williams. And I majored in English because of that. But my parents told me I needed a math. So I was going to be a math major, took a computer science class freshman spring, kind of on a whim, and that was more fun than math. and so I switched to that. And that was supposed to be the backup, but I took a sports writing class for winter study with Tim Leiden, who's a senior writer at Sports Illustrated, and I will use a lot of just a really amazing guy. And he got me in the door. I interned at Sports Illustrated the summer before my senior year. So I had that experience. I was writing for GQ and the Bleach Record. That was kind of how I pushed myself to ESPN. I found a job through a Wesleyan alum, so more NESCAP connections. But when I got to ESPN, everyone was like, so you're a computer science major? What can you do with that? And that was, I think, I'm actually 100% sure that's why they hired me, is not because of any of my sports experience, but because I could write and do computer science. And people kept pushing on that, and I found out that I like writing, but I am terrified of interviewing people, and that's a really important part of being a journalist. So the ability to like be able to understand writing and content, but also have a technical perspective, kind of just some people at ESPN helped me find the job I'm in now, which is actually a much better fit.
Yeah.
It's actually, I went from really wanting to be a writer to now being at a desk job that I find actually more interesting and challenging than the writing job that I have.
And kind of, I just want to jump in real quick. Building on what Dan said, like, I kind of arrived at the same conclusion as Dan in terms of knowing that that's sort of where I wanted to end up, but not because I had a different job, because I could have gotten a different job. And I think that experience is really valuable, like applying senior year or junior year to all the different internships you can here. That helped me out a lot, sort of narrow my focus. I'd always been interested in sports, it was sort of what I did every summer. But like Hank was talking about, when you're here, you kind of get caught up in. Not that it's a bad thing, but just what all your other friends maybe are doing, and nothing worked out for me, which ended up being a good thing because it allowed me to evaluate sort of more closely what I was good at, what I wanted to do. So I think that ended up being really valuable. So not that sports is something you need to be all going home about right away, but if it's what you're interested in, stick with it, and keep your options open. But trial by errors can be really helpful too.
Yeah, and Jake gave me permission to go into this a little bit more. He sort of like skirted over it. He applied how many?
I mean, I don't know. It was
10 years prior.
Yeah.
So like 10 to, mostly in consulting, a couple of finance.
Yeah, I mean, whatever.
And
whatever,
so,
whatever here, yeah.
And he was, top student, and we were, we were close, obviously, from our time at Williams, lived next door to each other when I was a freshman, or when he was a freshman, I was a junior. And he applied to all these places, and in the back of my mind, I'm kind of like, man, I sort of hope he doesn't get it, because I feel like there's something better out there for Jake, something better fit, and it felt like you were sort of like trying to make something work that wasn't quite who you were. And now, when I talk to friends, like, I kind of feel like Jake, of all our friend group, is sort of in the best fit for you, like, in terms of just loving what you're doing, and the role is really, really good fit. But 10, 15 applications that don't work out, and still sort of persevering and finding something, ultimately that is probably a good thing. And I'm interested for you guys, since you're watching, as you're thinking back to when you're a senior, you're watching all of your friends, get jobs, have these, their future sort of set, and the jobs in sports, usually you're not signing up for that in the fall or after summer internship in most cases, that those jobs aren't coming along until a little later. So I'm wondering, if you think back to where you were as a senior this time of year, when your friends are sort of haven't figured out and you're still sort of planning, what was the sort of stress, what was going through your mind there, and then sort of what allowed you to carry on and ultimately find your way?
I know for me, like when I started my senior year, I was 100% sure that I'd have like my brother like interned before his senior year and like he'd gotten a job and like my friends started getting jobs. I was 100% sure until like the end of senior that I'd have something before I graduated. And I ended up like getting an offer in IT that I was like lukewarm about. And actually it was my parents that were like, put it off like as long as you can. And then I heard about like possible opening at ESPN and sort of jumped at it. but it was getting closer. I would have to make a decision from that other valley. They would have cut off, essentially. We will not let you put this off any longer. But I was like stunned that that would happen. And looking in retrospect now, it happens all the time. Like, it's everyone I know that I work with now, nobody in my job when they graduated.
Yeah, I found out I had a job. Well, I thought I got offered a job. My last Monday night class, crime. Senior year, you were there. I get a cookie. It's a Monday night class. You get like that 5 minute cookie break. You never brought cookies. We're at the top of Hawkins, and I see my phone start ringing. It's on silent. My phone was only my desk. I was expecting a call. Usually get my bag. And I was like, oh, I have to take it. So I actually run out of class. And I get offered the job that day. And I remember thinking, I interviewed like a month before, and I was like, ugh, I blew it. I don't have a job. I'm going to like go live at home with my parents, which are actually really great about how much I pay for rent. But it was really, I was freaking out because I was kind of like Megan saying, like your anticipation and your expectation is so different when you come from school like Williams, that you're like, oh, I'm in such a better place than my friends because of the education I'm receiving. In a lot of ways, that's right. But just like applying to college is a crapshoot, applying for jobs is a crapshoot too. And you can be so qualified and so perfect and think you kill everything and it doesn't go your way. And that shakiness, that turmoil you felt is really, really unsettling. Luckily for me, in the time when my friend's like, oh, I just signed with JP Morgan, or I just signed with Credit Suisse, or I just signed with Goldman Sachs. Good for you guys. I had my thesis to worry about, and I was writing in historical fiction, so I had to spend a lot of time on that. And luckily, my BAFL season extended very far that year, and I think that was a nice way to transition. We went to the Final Four that year, so we played until this first weekend of spring break, and our spring break is late. And so like, that was my focus, and that took a lot of my energy from worrying about my job, but I could focus on something that I loved, and that ended up paying dividends, because I think that mattered to my next boss.
Yeah, there's a lot of that, like short-term stress, right? You want to just get it over with. You want to, you know, all of your friends are applying for jobs, they're getting jobs, and they have something, and you don't have something, and it's very tempting to say, I'm going to go out and just, you know, apply for a bunch of jobs the first one I get. If I like this, if it's decent enough, I'm going to take it. But I think sometimes, like in my case, it's like the best job I like the most is maybe one that's, you know, you apply for a little bit later, you get rejected from a few jobs, you find out what you really want to do, and kind of try to put off that pressure, try to put off not just getting a job for the sake of a job, and, you know, finding out what you actually want to do, and those can be the most rewarding on the line.
One thing that was really important to me, and I've tried to pass this along to some younger friends who I have coming up, is that, and I think it's kind of the focus of Nick's trip, about what you saw a little bit of the videos. There are a lot of people doing very remarkable, very successful things in very obscure fields that are not finance or consulting or Teach for America. Not that any of those are not valuable career paths, but there are a lot of people who go work in sports and are doing remarkable things. And the old athletic director from Williams, who's now the AD of Dartmouth, is a Williams alum. The new Williams men's soccer coach is a Williams alum. And so I think it's just important to realize that. Yeah, there are a lot of coaches, smartest athletes out there. No. But I think it's really important to keep in mind that you can be successful in a field even if it's not necessarily what's considered to be coming out of school with a good job, for lack of a better phrase. But that's sort of the sentiment that's thrown around when you talk about summer internships and stuff like that. And I think that is not entirely accurate, and I think that puts, like we said, a bit kind of strain on people, but try to keep in the back of your mind that that's not the only way to
do it. You also remind me to redefine success for yourself. Like the idea of Williams success or Williams College High successful might not be what you define as successful. I think that's important no matter what field you're in.
And I think it's important to think, you know, the folks I met on the trip, your first job is often not going to be the same job you're in, you know, even 2-3 years from now. But to Grace's point, the bigger thing for a lot of the people who I met was thinking deeply about what they wanted to do, trying out different things, and then eventually, you know, sort of a process My brother had a professor who said that his goal in his whole class was to make you have a midlife crisis at age 25. And he said, you know, you're too young and too naive to have your midlife crisis now at 21 or 22. But if I can sort of prime you to have your midlife crisis when you're 25, instead of when you're 35 or 40 and you have families, and at that point it's a bit, you know, much more problematic in the crisis. But if you have that crisis when you're 25 and really try to ask yourself some of those deep questions, then that's a really great thing, and it sort of will help you out. And I think it's helpful to remember that there's some patience. Like, you know, when I graduated, I thought, I was like, oh man, I gotta go right now. I remember, like, actively walking home from work and calculating out how much of my working life I had left. And I was like, I'm spending, you know, if I stay here for 2 years, that's, you know, 5% of my working life. That whatever it is. And it's an absurd way to look at the world, and trying to sort of calm down a little bit and take things as they come, while at the same time asking yourself those questions that can be valuable. Tied to that, we had talked a little bit before when we were just meeting about, you know, especially Jake and you guys who aren't working in the coaching world but work in the sports world, which obviously is so difficult to break into. And you guys all mentioned you know, internships, connections. Wondering how you navigated that process of sort of building yourself into a candidate while you're at Williams, and I think for the folks here, what you can do when you're here to prepare yourself if that's a field that you want to go into.
And building on what you said in terms of patience, I think Williams is the perfect place. Sort of when the stakes are low, you don't have to get a job, you're not graduated, you can pursue sort of whatever you want. If you sort of just like open, I don't know, there are a lot of different opportunities that don't present themselves immediately as a Williams student, that if you're willing to work for free, let's say, and go, you know, broadcast. And we were talking about this before, like Cape Cod League is an example of something where you can go be a broadcaster for a full summer on Cape Cod, and that's a great experience. And there's zillions of these random teams, whatever, that's, you know, just one small area. But if you're willing to, you know, as a 19-year-old, to say, hey, I'll work for free and go get great experience, that looks really good on the resume when you're looking to apply for a job later. And I found it was difficult to you know, get sports-related experience that when you go to apply for a job in television, like, hey, well, you don't like have a broadcast journalism degree. So coming from Williams, it's important to kind of seek those out and be proactive. That's what I found helpful, in addition to working for DQ, but also, you know, kind of opening your eyes to just random things, and nothing is too weird to, like, sign up for. I think just experience in sports is so crucial, coming from a liberal arts school, and then, you know, translating that to a job interview. I don't know, that would sort of be my advice, is just really broaden your horizons while you're here, because the stakes are a little bit lower. And you can seek out those jobs that don't necessarily pay you, but a good experience later on.
Yeah, we kind of talked about this a little bit too, but when you're in those internships, just kind of doing whatever they ask you to do, and soaking everything up. I think that was big for me too. When I was at ESPN Boston interning for the Red Sox, you know, if they wanted me to, you know, do some stat research, if they wanted me to go, you know, just run down to the locker room and just, you know, hold my microphone in front of a player or something like that, just doing whatever they ask you. I think the other big thing too is you gain connections and just meet as many people as possible while you're there. I found that, you know, when I was working covering the Red Sox, one of the writers there also covered the Bruins in the winter, and that's how I ended up doing my 99 for winter study following winter. So that's usually how it works. Is there are a lot of people. You'll find that the sports world in general is there are kind of connections all over the place. And so yeah, going in and soaking up as much as you can, talking to as many people. So you find that people in sports, if they kind of remember where you were when you were, if they remember themselves, you know, trying to break into the sports world and all that, and they're usually willing to help you. So I think that's the basic.
And I think making the most out of the opportunities we have here is big too, because being a SAAC school, being a Division III school, working in like sports information or whatever it is related to sports, you get different opportunities than you do at like Ohio State. Like, they have a bigger staff to do these things, and they're paying full-time people, you know, to write these articles and to do this and that. Here, like, we're doing all the broadcasts, we're writing all the articles, so make the most out of what you can there, like, gain different kinds of experiences. Like, I know for me, when I was interviewing, they made a big deal of the fact that I did color commentary for football. They were like, oh, that's different. Like, we don't have a lot of people that have done that. They get, like, you know, 1,000 applications for every job, and, like, this is different. So, like, what in the pile sets you apart? There are lots of opportunities even here that allow you to do that.
Yeah, I think the, you know, taking advantage of the opportunities here, internship and just, or, you know, internships or whatever you can find, and finding those people who, just like asking your boss to lunch one day, like that's not a weird thing to do. I think I was a little nervous about that kind of thing when I was looking at internships, you know, making those connections and finding someone who you think is interesting and saying like, hey, can you talk to me about how you got here? Like, can I take you out to lunch? Like, often they'll end up paying for you, which is nice. And then once you have those connections, I just remember, you know, this time, senior year, being so stressed that everyone else had a job and I had no idea what I was doing yet. But I had those connections that I could talk to and just ask, like, is this normal? And, you know, I had lots and lots of people being like, in journalism, like, these jobs are turning around, like, every, like, you know, you apply, you get it a month, or it's like a 2 month turnaround. So, like, the fact that you haven't applied, it doesn't really matter. Like, the job didn't take any of those yet. So just understanding the different timeline for some jobs than for, like, consulting, when you're going to hire you 9 months in advance. That was really helpful and reassuring to me as I was going through a lot of these processes.
Can I jump in by just really quick story? I interned with the Washington Nationals when I was a sophomore, after my sophomore year at Williams, and tied to sort of the idea of sort of doing your best in whatever role you're given. My first couple of days, I don't think they had an intern in the department. They didn't really know what to do with me. So they were like, here, you can open the mail. We get a lot of mail, and highlight it, and just if something's important, then let us know. And the other thing they had this massive stack of letters that kids had written asking for fan packs, which is like a backpack in baseball or something. But no one had time to make those fan packs ever. So there was, you know, years back of fan pack requests. And so I just did all my mail and then started throwing down the fan packs into, you know, my boss's desk. That pile started shrinking. And over the course of the summer, as they sort of, you know, said, okay, Nick can read the mail well and make fan packs, started to get more and more responsibilities. I think a month in before the head boss finally said, okay, you know, it looks like Nick's doing a good job. I should call him in my office and, you know, talk to him and figure out how we could help him out. But it was sort of doing those pretty mundane tasks for a while and just making the most of it that I felt like was important. And I think the other thing you want to go ahead.
Okay, so I did not at any point do any sort of sports internship. But like someone alluded to, it's a pretty small community and there's connections everywhere, especially being at a small school, you know, connected to other small schools. People are very receptive to hearing your story. I can mostly just speak to the coaching side of things, but ask around, try and figure out what's out there. When I wanted to make the transition from being a headhunter to coaching, I reached out to 10 of the other 11 head coaches in the NESCAC. You guess which one I did. And I basically said, this is what I want to do, here's my background, and every single one of them got back to me. Every single one, including one guy who had just been hired, who I'd never played against, said, hey, you won the games, that's great. You know, I don't have anything, but I'd be happy to chat with you and let you know kind of how you can make this happen. And so people are helpful, people know people, which is how I ended up getting eventually the position that I'm in now. So just don't be afraid to, you know, seek out what you want, tell your story, and then things come to fruition the more that you get your story out there.
And I guess the last thing I'll say on this topic, Jake and I talked a little bit before this event, and I think, you know, we're sort of saying all this stuff as this big process. It's important to remember that it's sort of like normal for job searching, that there's sort of a greased path, like a very easy path in certain fields. But for most people, finding a job, it requires a lot of this stuff and hard thinking working on some of those connections and reaching out to a lot of people. And so it's good practice going through it, no matter what field you're going into. Even if you end up going sort of a more traditional route where the recruiters come to campus and you interview on campus, if you decide at some point to switch, having some of that experience and having it built in is always a good thing. Want to switch gears a little bit since, you know, we're talking a lot about sports, but you guys are all, you know, current athletes. And in a matter of 6 months to 3 years, you'll be ex-college athletes. We're all ex-college athletes. I'm wondering, you know, put yourself back in the senior shoes. So, you know, your last game or your last race or your last golf match, walking off, and having that transition from your identity being centered around sports, which it probably has been, you know, since for you guys, since you were 4 or 5, you've been playing your sport, and then, you know, transitioning to the working world. I'm wondering how you guys dealt with that transition, how sports, you know, helped in that process, and what you sort of gained from that.
My last game was funny because we won. I didn't win a national championship. So it's kind of, so everyone says only one team wins their final game, and because there's a consolation game, we won. We beat Amherst, so that was awesome. And I just wanted to bring that up. that's all I have to say. No, so I walked off the court, and I didn't have that moment where I was like, wow, my career's over, because I was just so excited that we are at the Final Four of my senior year. We beat our arch rival. I hated every single person on that team. Katie would have broke her nose. Like, it was a great, great thing that happened. And I never had that finality where it's like shocking to my core that I was no longer a basketball player. I guess that kind of led me to not being ready to hang it up. And I really wasn't ready to say I am forsaking my basketball identity, whereas my five classmates who went through this amazing 4-year experience with me and had made all these accomplishments and completely changed the course of what everyone's basketball program was turning into, they were really okay with not being a basketball player. And it's not to say that they didn't appreciate the one's experience, but I wasn't ready to walk away from basketball. And so I think that energy that I had moving into my next job of being a basketball coach really helped me, because I was so in touch with my playing days. It also helped me that I was now scouting all these teams that I was obsessed with for 4 years when I played there, because Conn is in the SCAC, as you all know. And I think that the idea of a final game for me hasn't happened because I don't want to have a final game. And every game I coach in, I'm obviously not physically engaged, though. If any of you played the JV team yesterday, I am very physically engaged on the sidelines. I'm still as mentally and emotionally engaged in basketball as I was a player. So I'm only really missing one part of it. And I think when I'm kind of ready to walk away from the court and have like that final moment, I'm gonna know that I should stop coaching. But I think for right now, I'm glad I didn't have a final moment.
So you're gonna sort of transition it.
Yeah, I took, I'm still like 3 years ago in Michigan, like beating Amherst. I'm physically a much different human being. I can't quite run as fast, got a bad hit, but I'm still got the 3 for sure, so I'm gonna leave. But I'm still as emotionally invested in my sport. And I think that was a big moment for me saying, I'm really glad I'm not going to law school. I'm really glad I'm not. You know, I went to New London, Connecticut, where the population was college students. It was so weird for me to be 23 in a world where I'm coaching a 22-year-old, and now I'm at a high school, and I hang out. I was with 17-year-old for 4 hours today. I don't know the next time I'd be with a 17-year-old for 4 hours. But that's my life now, and I think that because of my emotional and mental engagement in basketball has allowed me to be so okay with being quote-unquote non-traditional. I don't love that LeBron is non-traditional, because why not make this traditional? Do what you want to do. Do what you're passionate about. That should be tradition. Sorry.
I think it's important to find your team. Whatever that is, that, I know that sounds like you've got a bumper sticker. It may not be an actual team. I am still on an actual team, as is Grace. It doesn't have to be a team. Like, I know a lot of people go into very corporate environments where they are really close with their team, and they get along well, and they give and take, and they work, and they persevere, and all the cliche team stuff. Or for these guys, you know, they're working as part of a team, they're covering other teams, whatever it might be, but I didn't realize that I had lost my team until I was working in this job in New York City that had nothing to do with sports. I didn't really like the people that I worked with. And that's when I realized how important sports had meant to me. And that's when I knew I needed to give back. But find your team. It may not be in a sports environment, but find the people who you enjoy working with, you can work together with, who are, you know, you can spend 8 hours a day, whether it's behind a desk or not, and be okay with it. I think that's pretty important.
This is not totally off topic, but that's a good point. Like when you're interviewing at a place, let's say, I know you're sort of focused on like, I want to get this job, but it's also kind of a two-way street. Like you should be sort of evaluating if that's a place you can see yourself being, people you be with 12 hours a day, you know, people you want to work with, that kind of thing. So I think you should keep like an open mind when you're going through that, because I mean, it sounds like where you were before.
Quick side note, for those of you who haven't interviewed, almost any job will sell themselves as a team environment. I was told the same thing about my job in Canadian, and it turned out to be a very cutthroat environment. So try and feel it out a little bit before you take that approach.
Do you have any suggestions for that, and any ways that you could have sort of seen if you had been aware to sort of think about that?
Yeah, I mean, it's hard in an interview situation. If you can meet as many people as possible who will be your future colleagues or coworkers or clients, whatever it is, I think that's probably the best way to do it. But also just, you know, have a conversation with them. I know interview situations is tough, but the more you can try and get to see what they're really like and kind of what the cultural environment is, you know, do they hang out outside of the office? I think that's a really important one. You know, at 8 p.m. every day when I got in my office, everyone went their separate ways, and I never saw anyone outside of the office. And it makes it tough to really get that engagement, where here, you live, you eat, you go out with your team every day of the week, and it's hard to kind of make that community when you're only seeing this person in an office environment. So one way to maybe kind of sit through it a little bit.
And I know, like, for me, we're still in Connecticut, where there's not a ton going on. And I have like two or three friends that don't work at ESPN. So all of my best friends work for ESPN. Like, I work on mainly the football shows. Like, we had an ugly sweater party in the winter. And like, every Saturday where they're really late and have to be back in really early on Sunday, with like family dinner on Saturday night, like the whole crew. So I very much found, like, moving forward, that it was helpful to have that sort of team that you fell in with. And I don't think that, like, I don't find that essentially related to sports. Like, in a lot of ways we do television, and it is sports, but the focus is that it's television. And still it's very much a, like, team, like, barring nobody on the staff can leave until the last person is done cutting whatever they're cutting, and, like, if we can help, we'll help. And it's very much a team atmosphere, which is very attractive to me.
And are there things that you guys do to actively promote that? I know one of the questions that we talked about earlier was, you know, you go from this place where everything is sort of set up to be team. You know, were you able to take some elements of, okay, I was in this situation at Williams, and I'm going to bring this sort of team spirit, you know, to the work environment? Are there specific things that you guys found in ESPN or Nesson that you've been able to bring in order to help sort of foster that sense of teamwork?
I know, like, for us, we create, like, work breaks for us surrounding our job. So we have a lot of, like, we have one show a week for the most part, and we have all week to prep for it. So we'll create, like, activities to do for ourselves, and we all sit in the same section. So, like, inside of work, outside of work, we create, like, things we're doing that day. And we made an agenda, sort of, that. And I think it was, like, a bunch of us started at the same time, and it was helpful that sort of a few of us played sports, and I think that was a big part of it. But we just instituted sort of, like, not rules, but, like, norms that started with that. That just, like, small things we did together. We go get lunch together. We go, we go on, like, a mini, do, like, a little snack run, like, probably do it. We do, like, little things together. It's all food, apparently. But, yeah, we do, like, small things as a group that I think promote, like, a team atmosphere.
Yeah, well, I think the one big thing that helps is that you all have, like, one huge common interest, right? It's sports, you know. So it's easy to, you're kind of coming from similar situations. I guess the one thing that was kind of tough for me is in the nature of my job and the people's jobs that I work with, we all kind of work different shifts, different hours. So I was covering a game, even if it was away game, I'd work at the office, I'd get in at 4 or 5, and you know, everyone else who was there is leaving. But I think that kind of, you know, in a weird way, brings brings it closer together when you guys are all together, when everyone is in the same place at the same time. You develop that relationship more quickly, and like I said before, everyone's coming from a similar place. Everyone has the same interests, so I think that helps a lot in at least when I first started knowing, like, all right, these people know where I'm coming from. These people are on the same page. Brandon, I'll give you the first word on this last question.
Okay.
We're running short, so I want to give. We're going to do just 5 more minutes on this last question, then open it up for, you know, if you guys have questions for 10 or 15 minutes. And if you have questions beyond that, feel free to talk to these guys afterwards. So the final question that we wanted to make sure that we sort of talked about as a group, we're sort of reflecting back and saying, you know, what were some of the things that you wish that you knew in college that now, a couple years out, if you could put yourself in the audience, that you wish that you knew, and how you think that, you know, might have changed where you're at. Don't feel pressure.
Yeah. I guess, like, even though it is really hard to break into certain careers, that having a Williams degree is a really big thing. People are impressed, and you will get a job eventually. And even if it takes you a couple of months after graduation, like, I literally got the call that I made the final round of interviews during senior week. So I graduated and still didn't have a job. And I planned like a big trip for after graduation, had to drive back from like the tip of Maine halfway through my trip to take my interview. But I think I stressed out far more than I needed to my senior year. And maybe part of that was necessary, making extra apply to things. But I wish I had spent a little bit less time stressing, a little bit more time enjoying my senior year and the people that you're with, because that's a really special environment that you can't quite replicate even if you have a nice team at work.
I would say there's an inner gray area between taking what you see to be a comfortable path and maybe an uncomfortable path, and maybe it's not about sports, something else that you want to chase with your passion. The time to be uncomfortable is when you have time to fix it. So I, from Conn, I could have went and been Harvard's assistant instead of moving to Cambridge, where my family's 25 minutes away, a lot of my friends are in Boston. I moved to Mount Hermon, Massachusetts, which is smaller than Williamstown, to be at a boarding school where the majority of the kids are high schoolers. There's 15 kids who are under the age of 30, 15 faculty. And I did that because it was a huge step for me professionally. And I'm 24, and a big part of being 24 is your social life, but I'm willing to sacrifice my social life to make sure that when I'm 30, I have the job that I really, really want. And it's okay right now for me to be uncomfortable, because instead of being 30 in a job I hate, which I'm 24, I decided to take a risk. And I think being afraid of failure holds you back more than anything else. Go somewhere you feel safe to fail. You don't learn unless you're uncomfortable. You cannot learn in comfort. So don't be afraid to be different.
Yeah, and I think the time that you think you're sort of not being productive, you've graduated, you don't have a job, looking back, that time is always going to be, you know, seem like it was nothing. But in the moment, you're like, wow, completely. I didn't have a job after I graduated. I didn't even have a hope of an interview after I graduated. And it wasn't until, you know, September. And then it seemed like an eternity. And then now it's like, wow, I would have traded, you know, an extra month off would have been amazing, because now it's not going to happen. So, you know, I don't know. I think you just got to keep it in perspective. So, like Brian said, enjoy your time here. Not that that's like pressure or anything, but I think, you know, the stress is overwhelming, and never is bad. It's just not that bad. You know, getting a job is not that intimidating overall. Like,
being away from here is a lot more stressful.
Yeah.
I would love to be in that life.
Completely agree. I didn't start my job until October 1st. You're going to work for 45 years. A few months is not a big deal.
I remember being really stressed out about like my GPA in class rank, and that like everyone applying to the job I was applying to would be like better than mine. And like no one has ever asked me that. All of the stuff that I was stressed out about, like as it relates to school, ended up being like
relatively inconsequential, like assuming that I've done like crazy poorly. And all the stuff that I actually learned has proved like really valuable. Like one of the things I do, so I cut like essays or montages or whatever for the shows, and it's hugely valuable that I can write something without having to be completely overthrown by whatever I read. So like stuff like that that I learned here is going to be really valuable, and nobody cares that like I do another 3-1. And like when I was here, that was like the end of the world.
One thing that's I guess more kind of my job specific, but I would say one thing that I wish I did more back then is just to diversify more and to do as many things as possible. In our industry, like the journalism industry, it's it's not just writing anymore. There's video. There's all sorts of stuff. So the more things that you can say you're able to do, and even in working in sports info, I'm sure DQ has all sorts of jobs for you. So there are so many things you can do. The field is still evolving, and it's kind of crazy how quickly it's evolving. But the more you have on your resume, the more attractive you're going to be to an employer. Yeah.
Awesome. Do you guys have any final thoughts? All right, great. Well, we want to open it up to you guys for questions. So feel free to throw. You can point at one person or just throw it out to your group. Yeah.
So I just have a question that's like kind of relating to racism, where about being like in this very group. Thank you. I'm kind of concerned between like what would you conventional group, like I'm being met, but I'm also like really interested in other fields, and I'm not really sure like if I can bring myself to be pre med or to the industry with like not be my good coach for that. And so like my general question is like what do you do when like you have a lot of passion, but like
I was not pre-med for a reason, because a lot of my friends were and it hurt me to watch them. So I think that's tough because there's two sides to every coin. It's like, okay, so you're pre-med and you're passionate about that, which is great. We also have these other passions, but does it make more logical sense to do pre-med internship? Sure. I think what Dan and I, what we did a little bit differently is that I coached with here. That that was my coaching experience. And I coached a club team. But it wasn't that I had this amazing experience that boosted that, the kinetic culture was like, I must have great mentors. Look at all that experience. I think what I brought was my passion. So I think if you don't lose that, even though you do, and I did the same thing, I went really safe. I did research for a history professor who knew people at law school, and that seemed really safe to me, and that made sense. And then it was November of 2012, and I graduated in 2013, where I completely changed where my passion was, I completely changed my focus. And I think it's that if you still have passion, you still have a purpose. And you don't shut your own window. Taking a certain job doesn't shut another window job. You have to physically do that by losing your passion for it. Then as long as you have it, you take the other job and you're like, wow, this really isn't for me, kind of abandoned, and you can still go out the other window. If that makes sense. That's not great advice. That wasn't like succinct or anything, but that's my thought process.
There's plenty of time to realize that you don't like something and change your path. Everyone up here is very young. So as long as you're doing something that you think you may be interested in, if it doesn't work out, fine. You're 22 years old and you can do something new. So just like Chris said, just keep your own mind open and you're never really locked into something.
And if you go to med school, I mean, I don't even know, but like if you go to med school, you'll be the first person who doesn't finish med school. Right? I know plenty of people who have gone to school and like, wow, I really don't like this, and left, and something different, and that's fine. I think being afraid of the other part of it, that will hurt you more.
I'd say to add to that too, when I went on my trip last year, I was really focused on like finding passionate people, and then to this race, it was like passion was really the guiding thing. I think in some ways that can be a limiting. Like it's great if you know what you want to do and you're like gung-ho passionate about it, like go for it, but it's hard if you don't have like a action, then you're sort of like, okay, what do I do? And then there's this golden standard that I have to be 100% passionate about something to commit to it, and that can be sort of unrealistic. But I think it was helpful in some of the themes that I picked up on in my travels last year was just following something that you're curious in. Like, if you're curious about something, and this is, I don't know how many of you guys are psych majors, but Professor Engel, this is like her big thing, right? That children learn best when they're curious. And I think that applies to college students and recent grads as well, that you don't have to be 100% passionate about it. You don't have to think you're gonna do it for 20 years, but follow some curiosities, try to learn, you know, stretch yourself to learn as much as you can, and you know, be broad, but also be focused and you know, following those curiosities to get to a point where you are you know, outside of your comfort zone. And then, you know, maybe then you realize, you know, you don't actually want to do that, or maybe it hits you away from what you originally thought your curiosity or your passion was. Or maybe you end up finding you really like it. But I think starting with that base knowledge, am I curious about this? Is it something I want to pursue for a little bit? Is a good place, and then also maybe something that's more relatable if you don't have a passion, so to speak.
I think there's also space, just like at Williams, even in the real world, where you have a job, even if it's like a 9-to-5, like a full-time job, there's space to like do things on the side that you're still passionate about. I've been running and like consistent coaching a little bit with Wesley and cross-country for our track team, because it's like, you know, within driving distance of work, and you know, trying to figure out how I can like shift my work schedule just enough so I can get there maybe once a week. And that's something you can still do. Passionate about, but like I like my job and I enjoy it, and that's challenging in a different way. So you can, if you're really careful, you can figure out how to do that.
Any other questions?
Do you think about like when you're in a lot of your interview with these jobs, but like what is your next step? I think like maybe some of you see yourselves in these places for long term and what they're giving you.
I think a huge thing is finding a mentor. Like for me, I got really lucky, like randomly assigned to a person who's been a tremendous boss to me, and I ended up like working on a lot of the shows. But really good mentors give good advice, not just advice that serves them well. So I think if you genuinely thought it's ever in my best interest to pursue something else, like if I was voicing concerns about what I was doing or I wasn't liking it, you would give genuinely good advice about how I could take a different route. What I should do to take like a next step in a different way, or it'll be great advice about like, what I can do to move up at ESPN. So I think having a mentor that you can ask questions to and be honest with and just exchange dialogue is huge.
I try to do it one day at a time. I think it's kind of, it can be crippling to say 4 years from now I want to be here. Obviously it's good to have a sense, but it's crippling to say this is where I want to be. And just focus on the end goal. It's a lot about the process. And like Nick said, sometimes things change, but also sometimes you just have to feel it out, how it's gonna go day by day, week by week. So for example, right now, I am looking to continue coaching, but I'm also trying to do graduate school at the same time in the sports-related field, so probably sports management, which was not necessarily what I wanted to do when I got coaching 2 years ago. But I think it's gonna help me continue to grow as someone who is both a sports professional and a coach. And so that's where I'm at right now, and I think that will help me get to where I want to be, but I still have no idea where I'm going to be 3 years from now. So I think have goals, have you know a general idea, but don't be afraid to look in the short term and just do what you think is best in the immediate future.
Awesome. So maybe do one more question, and then if you guys have anything else, feel free to come on that.
What if you guys found time for after work and also reconnecting with teammates? You know, how they go, you guys are able to get back together with people?
I mean, probably some of the folks at ESPN and Darren too. I work not really conducive hours to seeing people that, you know, I work on weekends and at night. But it's almost been a good thing too. You find new ways to spend your time if you have like a Monday morning off. You know, I live like in Connecticut and I can go drive and see cool things. So not that like, you know, you find like new productive ways to spend your time. I've been able to keep playing golf a lot more, which has been cool. And then it's allowed me to travel a little bit more and just sort of you know, explore new things. And that's sort of, I don't know, I guess sort of my hand has been forced by my schedule. So I think it's been productive for the last year and a half to kind of not be able to enjoy it socially as much as I maybe would like. And it's a balance, but I think, yeah, I don't know, that's not like super helpful. So to answer your question, I don't see much.
Very funny.
Yeah, but no, I mean, I think it's been like overall positive.
I'm kind of in the same boat as Jake, just working those 3 hours. I think you still find time to do the stuff that you want to do. I think the big thing for me is you'll usually find, Williams has a pretty good alumni network. Wherever you ended up, there's usually someone from Williams like floating around somewhere where you are. Another thing for me was just like keep playing the sport that you're playing if you can. You know, if you're play soccer, there's usually pick up soccer leagues that you can join, and meet other people there. I played in the summer baseball league and playing in that for 3 years. So you just gotta go with the flow. I think being open to I guess like you are Williams, open to trying new things, doing different things. I think that kind of helps you when you're working basically when everyone else is doing.
Yeah, I also worked, when I started, my shift was 4:30 p.m. to 1:30 a.m., and I had Mondays and Tuesdays off. So that was not conducive to seeing any of my college friends at all. But I still have ways. I've still seen, a couple of teammates that I've been close with. I still see, from time to time, for sure. And, I like dogs, so I'm going to dog place, one day a week in the morning, back after that. I think also voicing that you have other things that you'd like to do. If I wanted to do this thing with dogs, and my bosses were like, "Oh, we can make that work." You can't always do that. If I worked on a show that was on in the morning, that would be an option. But I think you also can't be afraid to ask for some work life balance too, because sometimes it's just as simple as I didn't know that they were being demanding of your time. I just wanted to do something else.
Yeah, I think definitely depends. Mine is so different because my schedule was very regular, but at a regular time. So when I was a college coach, between November and March, I worked 7 days a week, and I was in the office every day for 80 hours, and I worked every weekend. And a lot of times, as alumni, you go, oh, let's all go to the game when they play X team. And I was like, well, I have a game that day, so I couldn't go to that. But then I never worked during the week in the summer, except I worked every weekend. So again, I think, oh, it's kind of a week and we're all going to New York City. And I was like, well, I'm recruiting in the middle of Georgia, so I can't go, but have fun. And that's tough. I'm lucky where my teammates and my friends at Williams got really used to me saying, hey, I'm going to be in New York for 18 hours in 12 hours. Can you see me? Do you want to go to a Broadway show, Katie? And she'd be like, yeah, I'm in. And I think it's cool that you still just make the effort to kind of understand. I think it's kind of like Jake is saying, immediacy doesn't define friendship. I don't need to see, I also get jealous when my teammates with each other and I'm not there, but I can still have the same connection when I don't see them. And I don't have time, I don't have free time. This is my one night off this week, working at Board as well. I do dorm duty, I advise, I'm in admissions, we're reading folders, I'm in library. It's a lot of times, this is my one night, and this is what I wanted to do. I think this is really important. And I don't find it to be a sacrifice. I think that's kind of the clue that brings me. I love is that I can still feel like I'm connected to people that I've met during these months for 4 years, but my hobby is basketball, and I enjoy recruiting. I enjoy, that's what I'm gonna do on Saturday between two games, I'm gonna recruit. And it's a sacrifice you make, but sacrifice is how you find it. I don't find it to be a sacrifice.
Awesome. Well, thank you guys so much for coming. Thanks for the questions and everything. And yeah, thank you guys, the panelists, for coming back. I hope you guys enjoyed it and have us back at some point. So, thank you.